Hello. Good morning, everyone. My name is Sonam Chauhan. Today, I'm going to discuss about a very basic topic and very interesting topic of chemistry. So let's start with the introduction. Like we know that our environment and all the universe, it consists of different types of molecules and compounds, whether they are gaseous in nature, they are solid or liquid in nature. But the formation of compounds and molecules, how it takes place and what is the basis that binds the different atoms of different elements together to produce the different type of compounds and molecules. So that is a very, topic that is a surprising and very interesting topic, that what is the reason that different atoms combine themselves to form the molecules and compounds. So first of all, we must understand that why atoms combine with one another. So the topic that we are going to discuss today is chemical bonding. It's about the formation of different types of chemical bonds in different type of chemical compounds. So we will understand, first of all, that why different atoms, they combine with one another, what is the reason that tends them to bind and form chemical bonds. Then second thing is that what are the different types of chemical bonds that are present in different type of molecules and what are their characteristic features. So let us start with the chemical bond and different types of chemical bonding in molecules. So first of all, we need to understand that what do we understand by a chemical bond. So we know that different type of elements are present in our universe. There are 118 in total. Different elements combine with one another and produce different type of molecules and compounds. So what is the reason and what is the basic reason behind their combination? So it is a chemical bond that binds different types of atoms of different elements together and produce different type of organic or inorganic compounds. So how can we define a chemical bond is that it is a kind of force of attraction that exists between two different or two or more different atoms, and that force of attraction binds those atoms to produce a certain molecule or compound. So this is the basic, a very basic definition of a chemical bond. Now, why does this chemical bonding takes place? What is the reason that atoms do not exist freely in nature and they tend to combine with one another and give and produce the different type of molecules and compounds? So what is the reason of the formation of a chemical bond? So there are various approaches by which we can explain about why this chemical bonding is taking place in different type of atoms and molecules. So let us see that what is the basic reason and what is the basic approach that was given by that is known as causal approach, causal and limits approach, which was given by Causal and Lewis in 1916. So for understanding the Causal and Lewis approach, we must know about the valency and valence electrons. First of all, we already know as in basic chemistry, when we start, we have already discussed about the valence electrons and valency. So let us once again recall it, that what are valence electrons and what is valency. So in any atom, the number of electrons that are present in its outermost shell, it is known as valence electrons. Like here we can see different type of atomic diagrams are given, like hydrogen, carbon, nitrogen. So as hydrogen, there are only two electrons. There is only one shell. So that is the outermost shell, means the valence electrons in a hydrogen atom are two. If we talk about carbon atom, so there are four number of valence electrons in a carbon atom. If we talk about nitrogen, the number is 5, and for oxygen, the number is 6. So for different elements, the number of valence electrons is different. Now, what about valency? So valence electrons and valency, these are two different terms, and they sometimes in some atoms, the valence electron and the valency can be same, but it is not compulsory that every time the valence electron and the valency for a particular atom are same. So valency, if you have to define valency in a very simple language, we can say that valency is the combining capacity of an element. For example, if we talk about, if we take the example of carbon. So carbon is having four number of valence electrons, and to complete its valency or to complete its octet, it needs four more electrons in its outermost shell. So the valency of carbon is said to be four. Now, what is this octet rule and what is the concept of octet? To understand this concept, let us go and let us proceed with the Cossel-Lewis approach of the combination of different atoms. So Cossel-Lewis approach to chemical bonding. This was the very first and very basic theory which was proposed by Cossel and Lewis, which explains about the chemical bonding, why it is taking place in different if different elements and different compounds are produced. So Lewis pictured the atom in terms of a positively charged kernel, the nucleus plus the inner electrons, and the outer shell that could accommodate a maximum of 8 electrons. So Lewis postulated that atoms achieve the stable octet. It has been observed that when atoms contain 8 number of valence electron, it means that there are eight electrons in their outermost shell, the atom tends to be stable. As we can see, all the noble gases, the group 18 elements, they all contain 8 number of electrons in their outermost shell, and they do not react easily with any other element because of their stable configuration. They are not interested in losing electron either, not gaining electron. So according to this approach, according to this theory, Cossel and Lewis explained about the octet rule. Octet rule says that any atom of any element, it combines with any other element to complete its octet. It means to complete the 8 number of electrons in its outermost shell. So this is the basic idea that why chemical bonding takes place in different type of atoms. There are some elements in which they are stable in their free atomic state also, which are very least reactive, as I gave the example of group 18 elements or the noble gases. But all the atoms, they are not stable in their free state, so they tend to react with other atoms and complete their octet and achieve stability. And after achieving or attaining stability, they exist in the nature, and different type of compounds and molecules are formed because of this combination. And this combination takes place with the help of chemical bonding. So now we will discuss about that. What are the different types of chemical bonding? Do all the molecules, compounds, they have similar kind of chemical bonding, or there is a different type of combination that take place in different type of compounds and molecules? So let us discuss about the types of bonding. So if we talk about the types of chemical bonding, basically there are three categories: ionic bonding, covalent bonding, and metallic bonding. So let us start with ionic bonding. What do we understand by ionic bonding? So as the name suggests, ionic, which has been derived from ions. So it means that in ionic bonding, there is a role of ions, which is present in the type of chemical bonding. We know that ions are charged particles, whether they can be negatively charged or they can be positively charged. The positively charged are called as cations, and the negatively charged species, they are called as anions. So what do we understand by ionic bonding? Ionic bond, it is also called as electrovalent bond. It is a type of linkage formed from the electrostatic attraction between oppositely charged ions. As I told that ions are involved in this type of chemical bonding. So it is a kind of electrostatic attraction that exists between the positive ions and the negative ions of different elements. A very common example is of NaCl, which is an ionic compound, that is sodium chloride. Sodium here is present as a cation that is positively charged, and chlorine is present as an anion that is negatively charged. So to undergo this type of chemical bonding, that is ionic bonding, it takes place between two different type of elements, between among which the one should be very much electropositive and the other should be very much electronegative, as in NaCl. Sodium is an electropositive element, whereas chlorine is an electronegative element. So ionic bonding always takes place between these type of elements in which one of them is electropositive and the other one is electronegative. So this is the basic criteria or basic characteristic feature of an ionic bond, that ions must exist there, means one of the species must be able to donate its electron, whereas the other species must be able to gain the electrons. So this is the basic characteristic that is by which we can identify that which elements will undergo ionic bonding and what type of compounds are classified as ionic compounds. Like here you can see the diagram, diagrammatic representation of the chemical bonding, or we can say the ionic bonding in NaCl. Let us understand this ionic bonding in detail.
Electrons. Electrons, however, do not suddenly appear or disappear. They are, in fact, transferred from one atom to another. Let's look at sodium chloride as an example. Sodium loses one electron to form a sodium ion. The electron is not lost, but transferred to chlorine to form a chloride ion. So we have a sodium ion and a chloride ion.
So this is happening here because sodium is an electronegative element, and why, electropositive element, and why it is behaving as an electropositive element, there is a reason behind that. We can see by the electronic configuration of sodium, it is 2, 8, 1. In the first shell, it is having 2 electrons. In the second shell, it is having 8 electrons. And in the third shell, electronic shell, it is having 1 electron. So by losing 1 electron, sodium can easily attain octate. That is the criteria for being stable or for attaining stability. So sodium easily loses its 1 electron and attains stability by achieving 8 electrons in its outermost shell. Same happens with chlorine, but chlorine is an electronegative element. It tends to attract electrons towards itself, and this is the reason is that we can again look at the electronic configuration of chlorine. It is 2, 8, 7 in chlorine atom. So in the last, or in the outermost, or we can say in the valence shell, chlorine is having 7 number of electrons, and by achieving 1 electron, or we can say by gaining 1 electron, it can easily complete its octet. And this is the reason that chlorine is an electronegative element. It tends to achieve attain one electron and attain the stable octet state. So in between these type of elements, ionic bonding takes place, in which the one can easily donate the electron and the another can easily gain the electron, like here sodium and chlorine. So in sodium chloride, sodium will lose the electron, and that electron will be gained by chlorine atom, and it will become chloride anion.
They are oppositely charged ions and will be electrostatically attracted to one another, much like how opposite poles of a magnet.
And after they after the ions are formed, means the positive sodium ion is formed and the negative chloride ion is formed. As they will be oppositely charged, they will attract each other, and that force of attraction will be termed as ionic bonding in sodium chloride. So this is a very simple concept of ionic bonding. It is a kind of electrostatic attraction that exists between two oppositely charged ions.
Magnet are attracted to one another. This electrostatic attraction is an ionic compound because it is held intact by ionic bonds. The same thing happens with magnesium and oxygen. Why don't you grab a piece of paper and a pencil and draw
one more example we can see here is of magnesium oxide. Magnesium oxide, again, it is an example of ionic compound, because again here you can see the electronic configuration of magnesium and oxygen atom. Here magnesium is able to donate its two electrons and achieve the octet state, and oxygen, by attaining those two, gaining those two electrons, it will attain the octet state, a stable octet state. So again, magnesium oxide, which is having a formula of Mg2O, it will be classified as an ionic compound. So this is about the ionic bonding. Some more examples you can see here, some more compounds which are termed as ionic compounds are lithium fluoride, lithium chloride, lithium bromide, and so on. Deducting the formula of an ionic compound. So deducting the formula is already you might be knowing about how to deduce a formula. Let us once recall it, that how to deduce the formula of an ionic compound. So here, as we know, in ionic compounds, one species is the cation and another was the one is the anion. So we must be knowing the symbolic representation of those cations and anions with their charge, like here aluminium oxide. So aluminium is represented by Al, oxygen is represented by O. The charge on aluminium ion is 3 positive, and on oxygen ion it is 2 negative. Whenever we write the formula, these charges are interchanged, means 2 will be written with aluminium atom and 3 will be written with the oxygen atom. So the formula will become Al2O3 for aluminium oxide. In this way, by knowing the symbolic representation of different ions and by knowing their charges, we can easily write the chemical formula for a given ionic compound. This is the table which is representing the different type of ions, polyatomic as well as monoatomic ions, cations and anions as well. Now, let us talk about the characteristic features, because different type of compounds like ionic compounds, covalent compounds, they are having certain properties associated with them. So let us understand about the different types of properties. So we'll discuss about the properties of ionic compounds first. So the very important property which is exhibited by ionic compounds is lattice structure. Whenever we talk about any ionic compound, we must know that all the ionic compounds, they exist in lattice structure. What is now, what do we understand by a lattice or a lattice structure? So it is like we can say that ionic compounds, they never exist in a molecular form. For example, we discussed one example of ionic compound NaCl, sodium chloride. So sodium chloride will not exist as a single molecule in nature. It always exists in a lattice structure. Lattice structure, it is a kind of structure in which the cations and anions are arranged in a crystal lattice, and there is a proper arrangement. There is a certain number of cations and anions that are present in that crystal lattice. So an ionic compound is a giant structure of ions. The ions have a regular repeating arrangement, which is called as ionic lattice or crystal lattice. The lattice is formed because the ions attract each other. Yes, because both positive and negative ions are present in that lattice. So they attract each other, and that arrangement remains intact in that crystal lattice. this is the two-dimensional representation of a crystal lattice of sodium chloride or ionic lattice of sodium chloride here. All the negative circles are representing chloride ions. All the positive circles are representing the sodium ions here. Now, this is the three-dimensional rearrangement. You can see the three-dimensional rearrangement of a sodium chloride ionic lattice. So as we know that crystal lattices are very giant structure, several number of ions of chlorine and sodium are present in a crystal lattice of sodium chloride. Like here you can see that lattice arrangement is giant, and for example a single grain of salt, that is sodium chloride, may contain 1.2 into 10 to the power 18 ions. So the lattice arrangement continues in three dimensions. That is, this is the reason that solid ionic compounds from crystals with regular shapes. So all the ionic compounds, whenever you will see, they will exist in crystal structure on crystal lattices. So in solid state, they exist in their crystal form. So this is a very important property of ionic compounds, which differentiates them from covalent compounds, because covalent compounds exist in molecular states in nature, but ionic compounds exist in crystal lattice structure or ionic lattice structure. Now, some other properties of ionic compounds that we can discuss are, first is the high melting and boiling points. Ionic solids or ionic compounds, they have high melting and boiling points. It is because they exist in solid state in nature, and the electrostatic force of attraction between the ions, the positive and negative ions, is very strong. So to suppose they exist in solid state, so melting point and boiling point, it means that conversion of solid into liquid, we need to break the intermolecular forces of attraction to convert a solid into liquid form and liquid into vapor form. So to overcome those intermolecular forces of attraction, energy is required, which is given in the form of heat. So that required amount of energy is very large in the case of ionic compounds. So that is why they are having high melting and boiling points, because of the strong electrostatic forces of attraction that exist between, that exist in the ionic lattice of a ionic compound. Now, another property is conduction of electricity. Ionic compounds are good conductor of electricity, but not in solid state. They conduct electricity only in molten state or in aqueous state. Molten state, it means that when they are converted into their liquid state, and aqueous state is that when they are dissolved in some kind of solvent, in some kind of polar solvent, specifically water. So this is also a very interesting question, that why ionic compounds do not conduct electricity in solid state, but they do so in liquid or molten state. So the reason is that we know for conduction of electricity, moving charges are required. If moving charges are present in a certain material or substance, it will conduct electricity. So in the solid state of ionic compounds, the charges are not able to move because of the force, strong intermolecular force of attraction. But when they are melted, they are converted into their liquid state, or they are dissolved in a solvent. So the ions dissociate from one another and they are able to move from one place to another. And hence they conduct electricity in their liquid state or in aqueous state. So this is the reason that they show electrical conductivity in liquid state, but not in solid state. Ionic compounds are they are generally soluble in polar solvents. Yes, because they are also polar compounds, because there is a charge separation between cation and anion. Cation is having positive charge, anion is having negative charge. So that is why they are always soluble in polar solvents like water. They will be easily soluble in any polar solvent like water. They have higher enthalpies of fusion. Yes, we already discussed about the enthalpies of fusion and vaporization. That is, in simple language, it is called as melting point and boiling point. They are hard and brittle. This is one more characteristic feature of ionic compounds that they are hard and brittle. Hard, of course, they will be hard because they exist in solid state. So they are hard. And brittle is anything which is hard but can be broken down easily. That is called as brittle. So here also, if you apply any external pressure on any ionic compound, so because of that strong forces of attraction, and because both type of ions are present in that crystal lattice of the ionic compound, so when we apply any external pressure, the two similar type of ions will come in contact with each other and the structure will collapse. So this is the reason that ionic compounds are brittle, hard also and brittle also in nature. Now this is all about the ionic bonding, what is ionic bonding and what are the different type of compounds that consist of ionic bonding and how can we classify. Further also we will discuss about that, how can you identify that which type of compound contains ionic bond or it will be categorized as an ionic compound. So we will have this discussion further after this covalent bonding. So let us first understand about the covalent bonding and how it differs from an ionic bond. So we have seen in ionic bonding, in the case of ionic bonding, then transfer of electron takes place there from one element, from atom of one element to the atom of another element. Transfer of electron takes place there. But no such transference of electron is present in case of covalent bonds or covalent bonding. Covalent bonding is associated with sharing of electrons. Whenever we talk about covalent bonding, we have to keep in mind about the sharing. Sharing of electron takes place between two or more different type of atoms or similar type of atoms. The covalent bond is often described as electron sharing, as those electrons will be shared between the two opposite nuclei. Here you can see the diagram of a very simple covalent bond. Suppose these two white spheres are representing hydrogen atoms. So we know that hydrogen is having only one electron in its atom. And to complete or to achieve the stability, hydrogen needs one more electron to attain the stable state, because it is having only one electronic shell or only one orbital. So here you can see that when two atoms come closer to each other, the force of attraction and force of repulsion, both type of forces will exist between those atoms, because the force of attraction will be in between the nucleus of one atom and the electrons of another atom, and the force of repulsion will be there because of the nuclei of two different atoms and the electrons of two different atoms. So both type of forces work when a covalent bond is formed between two or different atoms, two or more atoms. So whenever the forces of attraction dominate the forces of repulsion, then only the formation of a covalent bond will take place and the molecule or compound will be formed. So let us understand more about a covalent bonding, how the formation of a covalent bond takes place.
Covalent bonds. In this video, you are going to learn about covalent bonds, how they are made, and how they form. If you haven't seen it already, first have a look at our video, Structure and Bonding. Only the noble gases exist naturally as single atoms. All the other elements of the periodic table have partially filled valence shells or outer electron shells. Atoms bond by swapping or sharing electrons in their outer shells. When very different atoms react, like metals and nonmetals, they normally swap electrons. This is ionic bonding. but when similar atoms react, like nonmetals combining with other nonmetals, they share electrons. This is covalent bonding. Nonmetals are found on the right-hand side and upper part of the periodic table. Some common nonmetals are carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and the halo.
So basically, when we see, we can observe that the ionic bondings are specifically formed between a metal and a non-metal, like sodium and chloride. So sodium is a metal, chlorine is a non-metal. So specifically, this happens only whenever a bond is formed between a metal and a non-metal. And when we talk about covalent bonding, so covalent bondings and covalent compounds are majorly seen when the bonds are formed between non-metals, among the non-metals. So predominantly they are formed by use of covalent bond and they are called as covalent compounds.
Halides. They have shells of electrons that are normally half or more than half full of electrons. Since they have a strong attraction for a few additional electrons, it is energetically unfavorable for them to lose electrons, so they share electrons by overlapping orbitals. This makes a bonding orbital or covalent bond.
So like here, a very simple example of fluorine molecule, that is F2, has been discussed. So fluorine is an electronegative element and also it is a non-metal. So as it is electronegative, it will never lose, it will never donate its electron to any other element. It has a tendency to always gain electron. So what if two fluorine atoms need to combine with each other to form a fluorine molecule? So they can never do that with the help of an ionic bond. So the concept of covalent bonding comes, the sharing of electrons, the sharing concept. We can see the electronic configuration of fluorine atom here. Fluorine is having 7 number of electrons in its outermost shell. It means that one more electron is required to complete the octet. So that one electron is shared from the another fluorine molecule, and we can see that these two electrons are shared between both the fluorine atoms, and hence the octet of both the fluorine atoms is completed by sharing of electron. So this is the reason that why a covalent bond exists, a covalent bonding takes place, and covalent compounds are formed. So basically and predominantly you will observe these in the case of different nonmetals when they combine with each other, where the ionic bonding cannot take place.
That contains two electrons. If there is space in the outer shell, a nonmetal atom can form double or triple bonds, like in oxygen or nitrogen. In the displayed formula of a compound, we represent a covalent bond with a straight line, like this.
So again, there are two different type of atoms, hydrogen and chlorine, and the bond is formed between hydrogen and chlorine, but still it is a covalent bond. Whether a chlorine is an electronegative element and hydrogen is a non-metal, it is not a metal, so it will not behave as electropositive, but yes, of course, it is less electronegative in comparison to chlorine. So now we will decide that if there are different type of atoms and the kind of bonding is taking place in between them. So whether it is an ionic bond or it is a covalent bond. So let us see first about the different types of covalent bonding, and then about the electronegativity of different elements and how to decide the ionic and covalent character. So this is the diagrammatic representation of a covalent bonding between non-metallic elements. Examples are hydrogen molecule, oxygen molecule, chlorine molecule, fluorine molecule, etc. Covalent bonding. Now, if in covalent bonding, there are three subcategories in which we can classify these covalent bonding. It is double, single covalent bond, double covalent bond, and triple covalent bond. So whenever a covalent bond is formed between two elements, two electrons are shared. It means for the formation of one covalent bond, two electrons are required, or we can say a pair of electrons is required. So if one pair of electron is shared between two elements, it is considered as a single covalent bond. If two electron pairs are shared between two elements, it is considered as a double covalent bond, which can be seen in an oxygen molecule. And if three electron pairs are shared between two atoms of elements, it is considered, or it is termed as, a triple covalent bond that can be observed in the case of nitrogen molecule. Now, as I said, that we will discuss about that how can we classify, or how can we say that a particular compound is ionic or covalent in nature. So for that purpose, we must understand about the concept of electronegativity, and then can based on the electronegativity values of different elements, we can decide that the formation of ionic or covalent bond is taking place. So let us understand about electronegativity. What does it mean? Electronegativity is a tendency of an element to attract the shared pair of electrons towards itself when a chemical bond has been formed. This tendency of an element is known as electronegativity. There are different electronegativity values given according to the comparison of the electronegativities of different elements, in which the highest values goes with fluorine, that is 4. Fluorine is the most electronegative atom of the entire periodic table, and the highest electronegative negativity value is 4, which has been allotted to fluorine. So now by knowing the values of electronegativity values of different elements, we can find out the difference in their electronegativity by subtracting the less electronegative element from the higher electronegative element. So now you can see there is different criteria is given based on the difference in electronegativity values of different elements. So for an ionic bond, means to classify a bond as an ionic bond, the electronegativity difference between the two elements must be more than or greater than 1.8. The difference between the elements which are present there, which are combining with one another, the electronegativity difference must be greater than 1.8, then only that bond will be considered as an ionic bond. The another thing, covalent bond. The another category is covalent bond. But covalent bond, again, it is having different types, that is polar covalent and pure covalent, or which can also be termed as non-polar covalent bond. So for a polar covalent bond, the electronegativity difference between the elements must be lesser than 1.8, but greater than 0.5. A polar covalent bond is a bond which is formed between two different type of atoms of different elements, in which one is more electronegative and another is less electronegative, like HCl. In which chlorine is more electronegative, so the electron charge cloud will be shifted towards the chlorine and it will attain a partial negative charge. The electron is not completely transferred from hydrogen to chlorine, but the charge cloud of electron, it is shifted a little bit to the chlorine atom, towards the chlorine atom. So that is why chlorine atom attains a partial negative charge, and this type of compounds are called as polar covalent compounds, and the bonds are called as polar covalent bonds. So for a polar covalent bond, as we can see, the electronegativity difference must be greater than 0.5. Now a covalent bond, simply if we want to describe a covalent bond, the electronegativity difference, it should be less than 0.5. And pure covalent bond or non-polar covalent bond, the electronegativity difference must be zero between the two atoms. It means simply we can say that in a non-polar covalent bond, the two atoms which are combining through a covalent bonding, they must be similar, like hydrogen molecule, H2, fluorine molecule. Both the atoms are similar in nature, so neither of the atom will be higher in electronegativity value. So the difference between the electronegativities will be zero. So that will be considered as a non-polar covalent compound, and the bonding will be non-polar covalent bonding. We can understand by using this diagram that what are the different types of covalent compounds, which are simply non-polar, which are polar, and ionic is a different category. So non-polar and polar, they both belong to the covalent compounds, and ionic compounds, they are a different class, a different category. So here you can see the non-polar covalent bond. The example of chlorine molecule has been discussed here. You can see in the diagram that the charge separation, there is no charge separation, and the electrons are equally distributed around the chlorine molecule. The charge separation is uniform. The charge distribution is uniform in chlorine molecule, because both are having similar values of electronegativity. So the electron charge or the electron cloud will not shift towards a single side. It will be uniformly distributed. And this type of compound is called as a non-polar covalent compound. Now the another example is of HCl. The diagram we can see where a polar covalent bond is written. In HCl, chlorine is highly electronegative in comparison to hydrogen. So that is why you can see the charge distribution, the electronic charge distribution is not uniform. It is shifted towards the chlorine side. It is greater on the chlorine side. And that is why you can see that a partial negative charge has been allotted to the chlorine atom, and a partial positive charge is allotted to the hydrogen atom. This type of compounds are called as polar covalent compounds, and the bond is polar covalent bond. And but still you can see that complete transfer of charge is not taking place, and this separates or this differentiates a covalent bonding and an ionic bonding. Again, here you can see in case of ionic bonding, complete transfer of the electron charge or the electron takes place from one atom to another. But in case of covalent, no transfer will take place, only sharing of electron will take place. So this is the basic difference between an ionic bond and a covalent bond. So that's all about the chemical bonding. What is the reason behind the formation of a chemical bond, and what are the different types of a chemical bond, and what are their basic properties? The third category is of metallic bonding. Metallic bond, actually, they specifically exist in metal atoms. They will be only found in metal atoms. This is a kind of, we can say, intermolecular or interatomic attraction between the metallic atoms. Here in metallic bonds, they are produced when electron orbitals overlap and all electrons are shared between atoms. This is often referred as a sea of electrons. You can see that the background, it is all negatively charged, which is called as electron sea, in which all the positive kernels, that is the atoms, metallic atoms, are embedded. So this is, we can say, metallic bonds are the kind of force of attraction between the metallic atoms which bind the different metal atoms together. This is often referred as a sea of electrons and is responsible for high conductivity, reflectivity, malleability, and ductility of metals. Of course, we know that metals are good conductors of heat and electricity. So this is the reason the metallic bonding, because here you can see the charges are separated and they are free to move from one place to another. That is why the metals, they conduct heat as well as electricity because of these moving charges. Metallic bonding is restricted to atoms of a single element, means metallic bonding cannot take place between two different type of elements, like we saw in the case of ionic and covalent. They exist only in a similar kind of atom. Suppose we can say iron. Iron is a metal, so it will only metallic bonding between iron atoms, it will only be restricted to iron element. We cannot say that iron and any other element forms a metallic bond. So metallic bond is a different category which specifically is restricted to the metal atoms and only for a single element. Two different elements can never form a metallic bond. For that, there are only two categories, that is covalent bonding and ionic bonding. So either when two metals are, two elements are combining with one another, so either they can bind with the help of ionic bond or a covalent bond. So this is the diagrammatic representation of a metallic bonding, that how it exists in a certain metal. So the blue colored circles are representing the metal cations, and the electrons which are ejected from those metal ions, they form an electron sea around those positive kernels, and that is how the metals exist in their atomic form. So that's all about the different, all the types of chemical bonding and their properties. Thank you.